is your life. This, the New London Theatre. And in a moment, I hope this stage will be filled with some of the most fascinating people it's been my fortune to meet. Right now, we're counting down the seconds to what I hope will be the climax of months of careful planning and thousands of miles of travelling to bring you a real cracker of a Christmas story. A story about someone who has been, not without justification, described as the most famous man on earth. Someone whose story has reached a milestone quite recently, a historic milestone, which is why he believes he's coming to a television studio to give an interview about it. Not to me, and not in front of an audience. But whatever happens next, I promise you, it's the most unpredictable Christmas I remember.
Gets right in.
Hello, champ, and a very special welcome to your second favorite city of London. For what I can say, the three-time champion of the world, tonight's Muhammad Ali, this is your life. We've got some lovely surprises for you. Very promising. We'll enjoy them. I must say a very special thank you to your pal and mine, boxing commentator Reg Guttridge, for bringing you along here.
He lied to me. I want to say one thing. I watched this show for years in the States, and I wondered why was everybody so anxious to get me here, and... this is terrible.
This is the right time to get you. Muhammad Ali, this is your life, and there could be no more appropriate time for me to say that as we reach the end of a year which has seen you fight your way into history by becoming the first man to win the World Heavyweight Championship three times over. You have fought in a total of 59 professional matches the world over, but for our next surprise, Muhammad, I want to remind you of a match which showed you a very uncharacteristic side.
I didn't know at the time, but later you told me you were scared of me.
Of course, your wife, Veronica. Veronica, how did you find out he was scared of you?
Well, we met when he was in Salt Lake City doing an exhibition. And when I met him, he didn't say anything. And usually he grabs and hugs people like he still does now. But later when I got to know him, he told me that that's why he wouldn't say anything, because he was afraid.
Well, it's not easy to contemplate a speechless Muhammad Ali, because the fact that you're...
Beautiful women just frighten most men.
The fact that you're as mercurial with your words as you are with your fists has made you one of the world's greatest box office stars. And if you look at that screen, we're going over 5,500 miles now to a city you know well, the bright lights of Las Vegas, where no star is shining quite so brightly as the one about to speak to you now. From his dressing room at the world-famous Caesar's Palace, your old pal, Britain's own Tom Jones.
Hello, Eamon. I must say I admire your guts for springing a surprise like this on Muhammad Ali. Muhammad, I wonder if the surprise is as big as the one you got from Henry Cooper's left hand in 1963. Putting all jokes aside, I'm sitting here in Las Vegas in the dressing room between shows, and as you know, anybody can pop in from time to time, like the time, I think it was about 10 years ago, in the Latin Casino in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. Knock him at the door, I looked up, and you were standing there. And we've been friends ever since. We've had a chance to talk together from time to time. I must admit, I like this this setup tonight, because I can talk to you and you can't interrupt me. You know, boxing is the only sport that I really like. I've always enjoyed boxing, and I don't think anybody would argue with me that that you are the greatest boxer of all time. Not only a boxer, I think one of the greatest entertainers. But speaking of entertainers, I remember the time when you recorded, you made a record, I should say, of a song called Stand By Me. Well, I would just like to say this. I won't go into boxing if you stay away from singing. You know, this is a switch. I'm over here in Las Vegas, you are in London, and I hope you're having a great time in my country. The only thing is, I wish I was there to enjoy it with you. But I'll see you soon. Oh, and by the way, be gentle with Eamon.
Thank you, Tom Jones, and nice to know you care. Well, Muhammad Ali, this is your life, and you were...
I still don't believe this.
You were born here at the General Hospital in Louisville, Kentucky, at 6:35 p.m. precisely on January the 17th, 1942, tipping the scales at 6 pounds, 7 ounces. Your father's a sign writer, and you're named after him, Cassius Marcellus Clay. Family home is here at 1121 West Oak Street. And it's there one day when you're only 18 months old, you show the first indication of things to come. You're swinging your arms as babies do.
And that's when my baby boy's left hand knocked my front tooth right out.
From Louisville, to surprise you, who else but your mother, Mrs. Odessa Clay, and your father, Cassius.
He's in my baby.
Odessa, how did you come?
Where did you get
here?
Answer any questions.
Okay.
You tell me how you came to be the champ's first victim.
Well, Ollie was always a large baby, and when he was a few months old, he looked like a miniature boxer. And when he was 18 months old, he was very strong and had big muscular arms. So one day he was swinging his arms like babies will do. I wasn't looking, and he hit me in the mouth and knocked a tooth out. And later I had to go to a dentist because it had loosened my other tooth.
Cassius, I know his nickname for you is Cash, but what does he call his mother?
Bird.
Bird. Odessa, where does he get the bird from?
Him.
No, Ollie used to always tell me, say, you have a small nose, just like a bird.
Well, today, Muhammad, you must be one of the most photographed men in the world. But thanks to your mother, we can show a rare picture of the future world champ, aged just 2 and a half. Sitting next to your baby brother, who's 18 months younger.
And looking at that picture, you can recognize that we have beautiful parents.
We've flown in from his home in Chicago, your brother Rahman Ali.
Oh, man. Man.
Now, being so close as you are in age, you've been great pals since you were kids, eh?
That's right. We always have did things together in life, and Muhammad always predicted from a small boy that he would be the world's heavyweight champion. And I want to exclusively bring that out because he always said, told the kids in the neighborhood, I'm going to be champ of the world, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. There were a few of them laughed at Muhammad, but he always had the strong mind, the determination to do it, to stick by his
my
word.
Shoulders are set
and
down.
He did it.
Tell us about hide and seek before you sit down.
In front of the world, I love him with all my heart. He's a beautiful people.
All right. Thank you, Robin. Ollie. Well, Muhammad, I know that hometown of yours has a great place in your affections.
All pay all the plane fares?
Yes, but we also hit the road to Louisville, if you look. And we went down Dixie Highway, to be exact, to a place where you were a regular customer as a youngster. Waddell's Barbershop, where your favorite barber is still at work.
Hi, Gigi.
And the barber is, of course, your father's eldest sister, your Aunt Eva.
Hi, Muhammad. Let me explain why they call you Gigi. When I changed your diapers, all you could see was Gigi. Later on, you said Gigi meant golden gloves. I became a barber because I had 8 brothers' hair to cut. So I had plenty of experience. Now, when you come into the barbershop, all you do is stop the traffic. Hey, Muhammad, you'll never guess whose hair I've been cutting. Jimmy Ellis.
Hi, Mom. You know, we go back a long time. You know, we had our ups and downs together, man. You know, we slept side by side, fought side by side. You have it in a lot of personal things. And I want to say thanks, man. You've been just like a brother to me.
Another satisfied customer. Next.
And in a Louisville cloudburst, that hometown pal of yours showed us how, as a kid, you used to race the school bus to keep training. Now, incredible to think that one day you two would fight each other for the world championship, a fight you won, but let's catch up with Jimmy Ellis now at his destination.
Hey, Muhammad. It's your school teacher from way back. This is Carter.
Oh, hello, Muhammad. You remember your old school, Virginia Avenue School?
Too.
How don't you come here?
I remember you.
Muhammad. It was in this very room that I taught you when you were 8 years old.
She's
in the third
there.
Grade. And you sat in this seat where Don Tavis is sitting now. He is somewhat like you. I remember when you were at that age. I reprimanded you one day because you didn't follow directions. And when I reprimanded you, your classmates answered, "Miss Carter, did you ever see him fight?" And then I answered, "Fight? Who has ever done anything with fighting?" But now I laugh about that, because since I've left the classroom, I've directed the YWCA, and I sent for you to make a speech. You not only made the speech, you brought me $10,000 for the drive and wrote the check right there. Now many boys and girls are happy because of the $10,000 that you gave. So fighting did do something for you. Muhammad, the kids have a message for you.
You are great!
You are the greatest, and that's the truth. Mrs. Carter and me, going to join your Aunt Eva and leaving that car over there.
And boy, are you in for a shock. From Louisville Airport, they flew right here to London.
No.
Your Aunt Eva.
No.
Your former school mistress, Mrs. Gladys Carter.
Miss Carter.
And just a little prior, your old pal, Jimmy Ellis. Aunt Eva, did you bring your scissors?
Sure. And it looks like he needs a haircut right now.
I can't believe this.
Well, now, Muhammad, as we've just seen, when it rains in Louisville, it pulls no punches.
I didn't know you all could last so much. Come on.
Well, it was on a rainy day your boxing career started. You were 12 years old, and Cash, you just bought him a new bicycle, didn't you, for Christmas?
That's right. A red bike. With chrome finish and white wall tires. He had got on it starting at home and it had begun to rain. So he headed for the local bazaar.
Just don't talk too long, because I got time to. I got my talk with him. See if he can start.
Well, I want to hear about this.
It was being held indoor at Columbia Auditorium, where he had found some free candy and popcorn.
A long show.
Okay, so you look for your free candy and popcorn, okay, and you park your gleaming new bicycle at the door of the auditorium. But when the popcorn and the candy are finished, ma'am, and it's time to go home.
That's when my talk has started, so I know it.
What happened when you go to collect that bike, the pride of your young life?
Huh?
Where was your bike?
I couldn't find it.
You couldn't find it, that's right. It was stolen.
You don't have my bike here.
No.
You
did report the theft to a policeman.
Joe Martin, he's not here either.
Well, I know that you when you tell that policeman what you're going to do to whoever stole that treasured Christmas gift from your father.
You said I'm going to whip him. And I said before that you better learn to fight.
Oh, that's
that same policeman from 24 years ago. Now retired Louisville police officer, Joe Martin.
Thanks,
and also from Louisville, your great friend and his brother, Fred Stoller. Well, now, Joe, we'd come to the right man to complain about his bike, because in your spare time, you ran a boxing gym in those days.
That's true, and he was very enthused about boxing at that time, and I had a show on television every week, amateur boxing, tomorrow's champions. And it wasn't but a short time I put him on that show, and that was his first boxing match, was on television. And
you tell you something
there you are, Muhammad. I have a picture of you.
No, what?
That's when you made your... You stepped in front of the cameras for the first time. What were you going to tell me?
Why'd you show that picture? No, he had a boxing show, and he was a trainer, too. It was in those days, integration hadn't taken place, and black people didn't quite have the opportunity they got now. So he had the championship show, and he trained fighters more physically than he did. And I would always train at 6 o'clock at his gym and sneak to his gym at 8 o'clock to really learn more about boxing. And then, because in the Golden Gloves, a lot of his boys would beat his boys, and I thought he was the better trainer, so I would sneak down and learn how to do. He taught me the jabs, he taught me hooks, and both of them together made me who I am today.
Fred, tell me.
So since you surprised me, I must tell you the surprise. I never told you this, but I always sneaked to his gym. See, because he had the complexion and the connection to get the protection.
Fred Stoner, if he let you get a word in edgeways, would you tell me why is it you think the champ here has managed to keep his boyhood good looks?
Well, in the early parts of his training, we concentrated on teaching him how to not stand still and be hit, to keep moving in and out and to right and left. And, look at him. It's paid off. And he's still a freak.
But tell me now, tell me, Joe, Ali was asking me, you didn't manage to find the bicycle, did you?
I can't believe
Never
it.
Never have found it yet, but we will eventually.
Thank you very much, Joe Martin and Fred Stoner.
This is a show.
Well, as Joe Martin has told us, your first ever match in a boxing ring was on that television show, Tomorrow's Champions, and we set out to find the first person in the world who came out fighting at that first bell against the future world champion.
No.
Today, he works on the production line here at the Ford plant just outside Louisville. And of all the millions of words written and spoken about your opponents, we were amazed to find no one had ever before asked your very first opponent memory of that day 24 years ago, but he recalls it now. As you said, you remembered his name, Ronnie O'Keefe.
Hello, Muhammad.
Is that you?
Remember that day I first stepped in the ring with you?
It
was your first fight. It was my first fight. And also happened to be my last fight. You were 12 years old. You weighed 88 pounds. I'm 14, and I weighed one pound less. We went 3 rounds. You won by a split decision. But I like to tell my co-workers here, that makes me better than Norton or Foreman and all the rest. You put them to sleep. It woke me up to the fact that in the fight game, I'd never be in the same league with you. But I have no regrets. I just figure I'm a better lover than a fighter. But everybody's gone here, so I think I'll do the same. See you, champ.
And see we will, to shake your hand again for the first time in 24 years.
No.
We've flown him tonight.
He's here.
Ronnie. Okay.
Oh, man.
Thank you.
present you. Boy, boy, time fly. We done got old. He don't look nothing just like he used to.
Jimmy Ellis, you and Muhammad were matched on that
first night.
Tomorrow's Champions program. Fight. I don't know if Muhammad remembers it, but
he's
you
my
do.
First fight. That made you famous too, didn't it? You the first man to fought Muhammad Ali. Ain't that something? Okay, what's
up? Thank you, sir.